Throughout history, most Africans have lived in rural areas, as the majority still do today, though this is fast changing. In fact, Africa's urban settlements have a long and proud past. Advanced civilizations were established in city-states, which sometimes developed into kingdoms. Lagos in Nigeria is renowned as one of Africa's mega cities. Nigeria, the continent's most populous country with around 200 million people, was created in 1914. But the history of the people in this part of Africa illustrates how urban developments stretch back over the centuries. In this episode, we meet the Oba of the Benin Kingdom, which gave rise to the famous Benin Bronzes, the Queen Mother of Lagos on how women helped run societies, and the Emir of Kano, ruler of one of the northern Muslim Hausa city-states. Benin City in southern Nigeria, not in the country Benin, is where the Edo-speaking people live. This is the Holy Arusa Church, and the elite of Benin, including the king, have worshipped here for hundreds of years. The people of Benin at first lived mostly in small village chiefdoms, which became city-states. By the 7th century, some of these had become kingdoms. From about the 11th century, one kingdom emerged, that of Benin, ruled by a king known as the Oba. The current Oba is descended from a dynasty that dates to the 1200s, and he's highly revered not only in Benin, but across Nigeria and parts of West Africa. I'm eventually granted an audience with him after a carefully planned and official request process. This is the palace of the Oba of Benin, and this is the hall where he receives visiting dignitaries. Now, this current Oba, Ewere II, was crowned in October 2016. But before he became king, he had a very distinguished career representing Nigeria in countries like Sweden, Italy, and Angola. So he brings diplomatic flair and a bit of an internationalist touch to the Obership of Benin. On the day I visit, a beauty pageant is also paying the king a courtesy call. There's a strict protocol to meeting the Oba. You have to wish him a long life in the Edo language whilst rubbing your hands to emphasize the greeting.
Zeinab Badawi, I thank you very much for this wonderful visit. On behalf of our distinguished chiefs and members of the royal family here present, I want to welcome you to Benin, welcome you to the palace.
What, in your view, is the role of the Oba in the modern world? We know that obviously they commanded huge power and influence throughout history, but how do you define your role in the modern world today?
We thank God and our ancestors for giving us the wisdom, giving us the good health, the strength to achieve what we have done so far. We pray that we have more wisdom to add to our wisdom, more good health, strength, and the wherewithal to do a whole lot more. Because I feel there's a whole lot more to be done for the people to get the Benin Kingdom back to its old glory days, back to what it's supposed to be, to have respectability, integrity from the whole world, globally.
Yes. I go to Benin University to speak to one of the world's foremost experts on Benin about the role of the Oba.
The role is to ensure peace and development within his domain, that the Oba is able to attend to his people in terms of alternative conflict resolution issues. The Oba is seen as the custodian of the culture and heritage of the people. The Oba is seen as the embodiment of the spirituality of the entire people of Benin. It represents the Almighty God here on earth. So that is why the people have a great deal of respect for him.
So how was the kingship established, and when and by whom?
The Benin kingship was first established by a ruler known as Igodo, and who took the title of Ogiso. Ogiso means the king with wisdom from above, or the sky itself, but the sky means above. And that was he who first established the kingship of Benin.
What was the basis of the economic system? How did the people survive? And did they trade with other people? Were they a militaristic people? Or what do we know about them?
They were engaged in farming, they were engaged in crafts, they were engaged in trade, particularly also long-distance trades. But the kingdom did not expand beyond the core areas of those speaking peoples until the second dynasty of kings, known as the kings of the Obas.
This dynasty of kings began in the early 1200s with Oranmian, and it survives to the present day, so the current Oba has a long and historic lineage. It was under Oba Ogwala, who was born in the late 1200s, that Benin's famous guild of bronze casters began. And this guild has been making bronzes for the court ever since, giving rise to the largest and most celebrated body of art metal in sub-Saharan Africa. If you walk along Igun Street in Benin City, then the bronze artwork for sale is just clearly in evidence everywhere. Here I've come to a workshop where the bronze casters actually work. And it's an ancient craft which is handed down from father to son, from generation to generation, and obviously it continues to this day. And it's a really painstaking operation that requires a great deal of attention to detail.
See this? There's a red head, red mud.
So that's inside. Red earth,
yeah,
red
yes,
mud.
Yes, yes, it's red mud. This one is dried already.
Uh-huh.
Then we rub it with wax.
Then you rub it with wax all over to mold it like this. And that's known as the lost wax method.
Yeah, there's a lost wax method. When we rub it, we bring out the face with the wax. We had the mat. Every design you see here was made up of wax.
I want to see some of the old examples of these bronzes, and so I go to the National Museum in Benin City.
You see the beauty and dexterity with which the bronze casters ply their trade and apply on their works is unique. And this goes to show and helps the Beninese also to wipe off all those prejudices, certain comments about not just the Beninese, but the black man. They were savages, they live on trees and all that. When you see a work like this, you know it must have come from someone who is very intelligent.
Back at the palace, I decide to ask the Oba what he thinks of the Benin bronzes, which, as I discover, is a rather stupid question.
Thank you very much for the question you have asked, but that question is akin to like preaching to the converted, don't you think? You know, to ask me how proud I am is like preaching to the Pope about Catholicism. So, you know, we're obviously very, very proud of our heritage.
I know that you have made tremendous efforts to see some of the ancient artworks of the Kingdom of Benin to be repatriated, and I wonder if you could just give us an idea of how that's progressing.
We don't even expect all of them to be able to get back, but even we would like some of them to be out there to serve as ambassadors for us, because wherever they are seen, somebody will ask, where is this wonderful work from? They will say from the Benin Kingdom, from Benin Empire.
Many of the Benin bronzes were taken out of the kingdom when the British defeated Benin in 1897. The old city was destroyed and its buildings razed to the ground. Most of the Benin bronzes are of men. The first female to be depicted was Queen Idia. She was married to Oba Ozolwa, and their son, Esigi, became king in 1504. This bronze of Idia at the museum in Benin is a replica. The original is at the British Museum in London.
She not only advised the Oba, she also supported and assisted the Oba in terms of spiritual matters. She was known to be a very powerful woman with great spiritual powers and authority that she deployed.
The original shows real attention to detail and, you know, very fine work and artistry.
Look at the hairstyle, for example. Chicken beak.
Or I've heard it called a parrot's beak
As well. Parrot, chicken, bird. And if you look at the hairdo itself, the way it was depicted in bronze, and look at the spaces created on the particular, you know, hairstyle, you see, if you take me a measurement, you see that each of them is equal to the other. That shows the attention paid by the bronze caster attending to this particular object.
I mean, it's a kind of, the hair is in a kind of cone shape, and then it's covered in a netting of coral beads.
Coral beads, yeah. Mm-hmm. Then, of course, you have the keloids on our head.
So there, again, you have the rectangular incisions.
Yes.
Just above the eyebrows.
Yes.
And isn't that because it depicts where thought and power is concentrated?
It does, but of emphasis is the Queen Mother herself. Who was she? What role did she play? You know, in relation to the son of Esigi, he helped him get to the throne and helped him win wars with the Ida. Our art in Benin is not art for art's sake. It's art, it's a functional art. Our art tells a story. Remember also, these bronze casters played the role of the chroniclers of our history. Our people were orally literate. We don't call them illiterate, because we don't measure our literacy level by just how you speak English. They were orally literate because they could communicate in Benin and they could depict events on their works. So the motifs on this artwork help us to tell the stories, the oral narratives of what transpired in those days.
Some striking images made during the reign of Oba Esigie in the early 1500s depict men with European features, and Theophilus explains what this tells us about this particular Oba.
Oba Esigie had, you know, a good supply, let me put it that way, full complement of Portuguese soldiers who acted as mercenaries. So they joined the Benin army to fight the Ida and assisted in winning. We should be able to establish the very good and cordial relationship between the Portuguese and Oba Esigi. All we know and remember the Portuguese for is their huge support of the Oba to win wars.
By the early 15th century, Benin was a walled city with wide streets and fine houses, captured in this sketch by a Dutch illustrator in the 1660s. Over the next 100 years, Benin became an empire stretching from the Niger Delta in the east to Lagos in the west.
It was during the reign of the warrior kings of Benin that Lagos was founded. And that was towards the end of the 16th century. And it was also the Benins also that ensured that the first Oba of Lagos, you know, was installed by them. And since then, up to this very moment, they still pay homage and royalty to the Oba of Benin. That area was actually part of the Benin Empire until the British annexation and conquest of Lagos.
So it was the Obas of Benin who established the Kingdom of Lagos. And the royal family of Lagos, who are from the Yoruba community, still pay homage to the Oba of Benin. This means the Edo people of Benin and the Yoruba have a shared history. Who are the Yoruba? Well, they're one of the best-known groups across West Africa today, numbering around 40 million. The largest populations are in the modern-day countries of Nigeria, Benin, Ghana, and Togo. Lagos is seen as a predominantly Yoruba city. About 23 million people live here. And the Yorubas have been an urban people since the 6th century, when they began to live in towns and established city-states like Ife, Oyo, Lagos, and Ibadan. The economy of early Yoruba states was based on the people's ability to produce food surpluses, which could be sold and taxed by the rulers. This, along with profits from trade, gave them sufficient revenue. As Professor Falaye emphasizes, Yoruba culture may have been urban, but that did not mean agriculture was neglected.
Settlements and commerce always go together, and that has shown in the history of urbanization among the Yorubas. If you visit most Yoruba towns, you will find that they are largely established along important roads or rail lines, either of the two. And because Yoruba cities and towns are not necessarily settled around rivers like you have in maybe northern parts of West Africa, you also have huge reliance on agriculture. Agriculture, not in the sense of fisheries, but in the sense of the real agriculture that we know, going to the farm, planting yams, planting cocoyam, planting cassava. These have been the hallmark of Yoruba civilization.
And the food that you've eaten for centuries.
Of course, Yorubas planted all the food. The importation of food started maybe much later. Yorubas were self-reliant in terms of the agricultural produce which they consumed.
So even though they're an urbanized people, they obviously made sure they were farmers.
Urbanization and farming went together, hand in hand, or hand in glove, as they say.
From about the 8th century, Yoruba kingdoms developed, and one of the most prominent today is that of Lagos. I go to the traditional palace on Lagos Island, home of the Erelu Kuti, which is a title given to the Queen Mother. She's holding one of her regular 9-day gatherings, attended by her lively priest. As the Erelu Kuti, she wields much influence. For instance, when a king dies, she would reign as regent until a new monarch is chosen.
You know, I've been Erelu for a long time, over 40 years. And you know, when a new king comes, of course, he wants to put on his own stamp and lay his own claim. So naturally, there'll be a little bit of tension. But in the end, we get to understand each other and extend to each other the courtesies that one another deserves, and therefore listens to advice, and because the whole idea is to move the kingdom forward for good, and we do have that kind of cooperation. The present Oba of Lagos laid his claim to the throne through Erelu Kuti.
His mother,
which is something that is very important in the empowerment, emancipation of womanhood.
The Queen Mother also has a role to play in traditional worship, and her palace has a shrine to the supreme god Olodumare.
A palace is not a palace if you don't have a shrine where you will appeal to your ancestors to intercede in their affairs. of the families they've left behind. We do that on a daily basis. And formally, every 9 days, we sit down. What you see today, you see every 9 days, where we come to commune together, drink, pray, eat, you know, appealing to our ancestors to intercede for us with the Olodumare. But you know, you can see I take so many drinks. If I have to drink every one of them, I won't be able to take this interview. So what I do is I give it to the priest that brings it to me, and he drinks it on my behalf.
So your priest gets drunk?
Well, I think he enjoys it. He doesn't show. I've given him about three already. It has not made any difference, you know.
The Queen Mother offers her priest as a guide to take me to the market to meet some of the women there. She takes very seriously her responsibility for promoting their interests in her domain and has many charitable projects for them. I give the ladies who pound the yam a hand, but not for too long.
Better than I am.
Thank you. You're welcome.
I've heard there's a play in rehearsal about a market woman called Iyajola, Queen of the Market, starring one of Nigeria's leading ladies, Joka Silva. Her character, Iyajola, has recently been widowed, and her late husband's relatives come to evict her from the land and seize her home.
They have not allowed me to see his body. I close all my shop and I go to my house to cry for my husband.
We are the brothers of the owner of this house.
Yes.
Huh? See all these people for our gate. I've not known that landlord have family plenty like that.
We have come to collect our brother's property.
Yes.
Please, don't be annoying. Your brother have not get anything.
In history, the reason why the woman didn't inherit land was because she would then be married off to somebody else in the husband's family. The modern woman doesn't want to be married off to anybody. It's a case of, I am entitled to my own inheritance. We're using the theater, the performance art, to advocate for women's rights, to advocate for men's rights as well. Actually, we do that in this play. We try and free men from the incredible responsibility that and pressure that patriarchy, you know, puts on them.
So theatre builds on African oral tradition, and this is something which the Igbo people are particularly renowned for. These Igbo market sellers are using chants and music to attract buyers for their goods. The Igbo dominate the eastern part of what is today Nigeria. By the mid-20th century, a strong sense of ethnic identity had developed amongst them. Historically, most Igbo have been subsistence farmers, and land is still owned communally by kinship groups. The largest political unit was about 5,000, and authority was vested in a council of chiefs and wealthy men, not a kingdom. One senior Igbo historian at Lagos University gives some highlights of their culture.
Families have pieces of land they recognize as their own. So in the community where everybody is free to move about or farm, you farm on a piece of land that belongs to you. But if you don't have enough to cultivate or to farm, you can ask from your neighbors.
How would you describe the Igbo worldview then?
When you talk about the Igbo worldview, you are talking about their belief system, the Omenala. The Omenala embodies their worldview, their ideology, their tradition, their custom, their perception of the world, their perception of life, their idea of creation, and all that. So when you talk about the Igbo worldview, it is all compassing, how they view the world,
One eye-catching aspect of Igbo culture is that you have your own calendar. There are 4 days in a week, 7 weeks in a month, and 13 months
beautiful,
in a year.
Beautiful. There's so, you know so much about it.
How did that come about? Why? Do you still use it?
We do. These 4 days in a week, they have names. And those names are still alive in Igbo land because they are market days.
One cannot do justice to the many people in this part of Africa in just one program. But after the break, we go north to visit a Muslim Hausa city-state. The Muslim heritage of northern Nigeria is critical to an understanding of Muslim West Africa. We start with the Kingdom of Kano, which was established in the 9th century, lasting until the 14th century. At its height, it covered much of the Chad Basin and modern-day northeastern Nigeria, parts of southern Libya, eastern Niger, and northern Cameroon. Its first king, known as the Mai, was Humay, who was born in the late 11th century. And historian Tunde Oduwobi says we know little about him, though it's believed Islam very much spread during his reign.
Humay clearly must have been a Muslim. And I also believe that his coming to power must have been facilitated by his association with the, what we call it, the trans-Saharan trade. He was clearly a Muslim because he actually died on a pilgrimage on the way to Mecca in Egypt.
From around 1210, the reign of the great king of Kano began, Dunama Dibalami, who was renowned for his huge cavalry.
Well, the king has several thousand. That's to tell you how successful the state was in terms of trade. Horses were very expensive, mind you, and so it tells you the extent, you know, of the huge the nature of the trade between Kano and North Africa.
By the late 14th century, the Borno Empire, sometimes referred to as the Kanem-Borno Empire, had emerged. And the best-known king, or Mai, is Idris Eluma, who reigned for more than 30 years. He was an accomplished military man, skilled administrator, and gifted diplomat. And under his rule, the Borno Empire flourished.
Funny enough, most of what we know of Idris Eluma was just about 12 years of his reign, because some of these things were actually documented. We don't know what happened thereafter. So for 12 years, it became so magnified. No doubt it was a glorious reign. And again, for Idris Eluma too, with him came the period of firearms, one of the reasons why he was successful.
Amongst the nominal subjects of the Borno Empire were the Hausa, one of the biggest ethnic groups in West Africa. At around 40 million, they are found across many modern-day countries, and their culture is sometimes referred to as the Hausa Fulani. The Muslim Hausa states developed between the 11th and 13th centuries. The inhabitants were pastoralists or farmers. In time, they built walled cities which became capitals of states. The oldest is Kano. Other well-known ones include Katsina, Zamfara, and Zaria.
What was the relationship like between the Borno Kingdom and the Hausa states in northeastern Nigeria? Was it one of antagonism?
I wouldn't describe that as such. I would just say tributary status. Simple. They were not, strictly speaking, part of the empire, but they acknowledged the sovereignty of the Mai. Pay tributes and I will let it be.
Kano, which was established at the foot of the Dala Hills, based its wealth on agriculture, trade, and manufacturing, and was renowned for what became the biggest market in West Africa, the Kurmi market. Kano also has one of the best preserved city walls.
This is part of the ancient city wall of Kano, and it's one of the most important historic monuments in West Africa. Built of earth, it has a radius of about 14 kilometers. It was started at the end of the 12th century and was established by the rulers of Kano primarily for security and defense purposes. Mustn't slip again. Whoops, I just did.
I go to the museum at Kano, which was once the Emir's palace, to meet Professor Sule Bello.
If you take Kano as a case study of how these various city-states emerged, you could look at it as follows. Migrants who came and settled around the Dala Hill, because they were able to mine iron ore, the rivers, fertile land and forests for hunting. So it became more or less an urban and a commercial center. And that was why it developed into a city-state. And with these state institutions, they had emerged local as well as long-distance trade.
So how did this part of the Sahel in West Africa fit into the history of Africa, and over what kind of centuries are we talking about? I mean, Kano became the hub of the Trans-Sahara trade, for instance.
You are talking of about a period about 8 to 9 centuries of development, largely from the, let's say, 1000 AD to 1900s, to the coming of the British.
Why was Kano in such a good position to exploit trade?
I think two important things. One, the fertile nature of Kano, which is one of the most fertile areas in Nigeria where agriculture is concerned. Agriculture developed extensively. Industry developed extensively within the urban centers, and therefore there was this textile production, dyeing of clothes, and so on and so forth. The textile industry was clothing virtually the whole of West Africa.
As I see for myself when I visit a dye pit, Kano is still extremely skilled in the weaving and dyeing of cotton cloth.
This is the Kofar Mata dye pit in Kano, and it's been here since 1498. And this is where they dye fabrics in that beautiful indigo colour that's so prized right across Africa.
The site manager, Yusuf Sani, adds a bit of colour to the process for me.
So this is the process, the ingredient, and the, how the man is dipping the cloth inside and the outside to make it. That is all.
And what are the ingredients? And
it's only three ingredients. The ash, the potassium and the indigo mixed together, then we get the solution.
The indigo plant gives a deep, rich and intense colour.
This is the darker, and this is the process of making the beginning. It starts turning the yellowish. Then later when the air blows it, then it starts changing. Slowly, it would be like as you see it now.
And how long have you been working here?
Shekara kanawa kana aiki. Kai shekara noa. I have been here for more than 45 years working here.
And did your father and your grandfather before you do this work?
Kaga dani a wajen babanka a wajen kakanka ya akai ka fara.
Kakanka kana ya kakan kakan babana ya daidaza wajen kakansa.
I inherited it.
Kakana ka zo kuma kan kubana.
I inherited it from my grandfather, then my father, then I am now. Then I am teaching my son to do the process. Yeah. This is the family business from one generation to another generation.
Kano enjoyed an economy as vibrant as its fabric dyes, and its people prospered. Then, in the early 19th century, a major upheaval took place. Thank you. there was an Islamic revolution across West Africa, including against the ruling dynasties of the Hausa states, led by pious men, most notably Sheikh Uthman Danfodio, whose family had for centuries lived in the Hausa states. He was a religious scholar and military leader who spurned the trappings of power. Islamic revolutionaries such as he were supported by the local populations who resented the greed of their rulers.
The major grievance was that the rulers were extortionate. They engaged in extortion, engaged in various kinds of things which were not acceptable, which were corrupt. So that was the major reason. And secondly, they wanted, I think, more importantly, to establish a more peaceful environment where trade and relations between the states could be better.
New ruling dynasties were established in the Hausa city-states, and they became emirates, paying allegiance to the Sultan of Sokoto. The emirs still enjoy high status, as I discover when I visit Kano's current emir, Muhammad Sanusi II. The Emir of Kano lives in a magnificent palace complex in the old part of the city. And I'll just show you around some of the rooms. This dome-shaped room is a waiting area for visiting dignitaries like ministers and ambassadors. But sometimes the Emir himself will sit on that seat there and listen to people's concerns. Sometimes people might present informal petitions here. Now, this room here is known as England Hall because it was built in honour of Queen Elizabeth of the United Kingdom when she paid a visit many, many decades ago to Nigeria. And the then Emir of Kano built this room in her honour so that he could receive her. So every Friday, the Emir of Kano will come and sit here and he will receive his guests. Some of them may have petitions, some of them seeking advice from him. And obviously he sits there and everybody else will be sitting on the floor. This portrait here is of Muhammadu Sanusi I, who is the grandfather of the current emir, but he prefers to style himself as Muhammad Sanusi, omitting the U of his grandfather, and he was knighted. So he was Sir Muhammadu. Strong family resemblance. Sir Muhammadu had many dozens of concubines, and one of them, Rahamatu Adamu, in fact, still lives in the palace complex. Today, the emir has no concubines, just four wives. The current emir, as plain Lamido Sanusi, the governor of the Central Bank of Nigeria, was one of the best-known Nigerians in international circles. He's been meeting a delegation of students and teachers who depart as I enter his private quarters.
The authority of the emirs of northern Nigeria started as a purely religious authority. Those initial jihad leaders were Islamic scholars. They were also military generals. And when they became kings, they sought to establish the Sharia and Islamic law. So the descendants of those emirs are inheritors of that culture and that tradition. And even where a particular emir himself may not be a scholar or deeply learned in religion, he's expected to be guided by the scholars and by the sources and by the Sharia in whatever he does.
Quite a demanding job then, because of course you were, when you were Lamido Sanusi, governor of the Central Bank of Nigeria, you swapped the bank's boardroom for a palace. How did you make that adjustment from the kind of cut and thrust of the banking world to this very traditional role?
First of all, I think I have one advantage in that I have always wanted to be an emir. And I've always considered this to be my dream job. We do not necessarily have a constitutional role. We have continued to exert a lot of influence and a positive influence. And we continue to play the role of justice of the peace. People still come to us. If you come to the courts, people still come to us. They come with cases, marital cases, civil cases, commercial cases. We don't jail anyone. We don't try criminal cases. But 90% of the disputes in this part are settled in the Emir's court or the district head's court.
The Emir of Kano regularly goes out to meet his subjects, and today he's setting off to the village of Tofa. It's about a 45-minute drive, but the journey takes nearly twice as long because the Emir's convoy is stopped by people waiting on the roadside, trying to get a glimpse of him and to greet his entourage. When the Emir arrives, he hands out certificates to graduates of a Quranic school meticulously, one by one, in a long ceremony that feels even longer in the searing heat. The Emir of Kano may not wield the power his predecessors once enjoyed, but the heirs of the House Estates are an embodiment of history. And as Professor Bello points out, these city-states carry huge significance in discussions about Africa's place in world history.
I think one or two things could be emphasized. Because of the nature of the confrontation at the level of understanding or theory between the imperial powers and African nationalists and professional historians, they have developed this perspective. One, that the state is the epitome of civilization. That when you have states, like the Europeans would argue, the European states, the invention of writing technology, etc., they constituted civilization. Their argument is that Africa, you didn't have this, therefore there was no civilization. I think what the people who are trying to establish that there were states in Africa were trying to do was to say, no, we had states in Africa, and therefore there was civilization in Africa. I think this is well taken, and it has been proved beyond any reasonable doubt that there were various states in Africa.
UNESCO's General History of Africa, the continent's history written and told by Africans themselves, states there were several kinds of sophisticated political formations in Africa, such as the established communities of the Igbo, or city-states like Lagos and Kano, which developed into emirates and kingdoms. So modern nation-states in Africa that are fast urbanizing clearly have deep historic roots in urban culture and civilizations. In the next episode, we travel east and find out about the great Swahili coastal civilizations along the Indian Ocean and the slave trade across its waters.